Hi, my name is Lena and welcome to my channel, and let's talk about The Silmarillion by Tolkien. It's a buddy read with Lukash from the channel Lukash's Books. And this time we read chapter 20 of the fifth battle near Nayeth Arnoyediad and chapter 21 of Turin Turanbar. And you can see that I have almost finished the book. I have three chapters to go to the end of the Silmarillion, and then start something else, something that is called Akalabes and the downfall of Numenor. And basically this part of the book. So I have some maybe 100 pages, maybe 120 pages, and those are family trees and index, name index, and maps, and some notes on pronunciation. So I'm almost through. So basically, after Beren and Lucien managed to get a Silmaril from the crown of Morgoth, Maedhros, the eldest son of Fëanor, he saw that Morgoth can be vanquished, then he can be defeated, and he decided to attack him. To gather elves, dwarves, and men and attack him. But unfortunately, he didn't get enough help because he was a son of Fëanor, and many elves don't love them. Maybe many people too, especially Kelagorm and Curufin, who had no honor whatsoever and acted like bullies, and they publicly threatened King Thingol and all his elves unless they return the Silmaril, because sons of Fëanor consider it to be their heirloom. So most of them are very unpleasant lot, and although Maedhros is, I like him, he seems to be a very good elf, a very good guy. So many people, many elves, many dwarves came to fight alongside him, but many didn't. And of course there was a lot of treachery, because treachery is the way Morgoth operates. So he turns elf people and elves and dwarves on each other. That's how he works. So there was a lot of treachery, and there were Balrogs, and there were werewolves, huge wolves with riders, and there was Glaurung, who is the father of the dragons, and no one but dwarves could withstand him, because dwarves wear masks. So dwarves wear armor from head to toes. I cannot understand how it could help them, but nevertheless they could withstood the father of dragon. Men and elves and other people, they couldn't. They would just scatter if they are lucky. And it reminds me of the way Tolkien drew his car. He liked driving car, but he wasn't very good at them. And his approach was basically, and I think it's his quote, charge them and they will scatter. It's about the people on the streets. So, nevertheless, many good elves, people and dwarves died, and Morgoth won. I have no idea why I always try to name him Macbeth. I'm sorry, guys. Morgoth won. He also took Húrin as a prisoner and slayed his brother Hor. And I think it wasn't enough for him because he cursed the entire family, Húrin and his entire family. So his wife Morwen, his son Túrin, and his daughter Nienor. So the tale of Túrin Túrambar is basically the tale of the curse. Túrin, from the age of 8, I think, was fostered in Doriath, and King Thingol loved him as his own son. But Túrin had to flee because of a tragic accident. And later on, he was too proud to come back when King Thingol asked him to come back, and when he asked to tell Túrin that he was pardoned. So he was too proud to be pardoned and to return to Doriath. He preferred roaming the lands of Middle-earth and fighting orcs with different bands of people. And he knew about the curse, and he believed in this curse because he kind of brought death and ruin to people around him. So he believed in this curse, and that's why he changed his name. He always took different names. He thought that if he is not called, he wasn't called Túrin, the son of Húrin, that he won't be subjected to this curse. This curse will never find him, something like that. And maybe because of this curse, he unfortunately, by mistake, killed his best friend, an elf who tried to save him and saved him. And afterwards, he married his own sister. Because of the curse. So he roamed the Middle-earth and he fought orcs, and some troop of people or elves would take him in, and he was a very violent man, and he would earn their respect, and when they would find out that he is Túrin, son of Húrin, it would get him even more respect. But after the war was lost, people, elves and dwarves, they kind of went into hiding. So all the battles they fought were guerrilla style. So they would ambush orcs, they would attack them from the back and kill them when they are unawares. And Túrin was too proud for that. He wanted an open fight, he wanted another kind of war. And so he would get the respect of people, and he would steer people around him, and they would stop listening to their leaders, and they would follow him. They would follow Turing. And it kind of always leads to death and destruction and enslavement. And he would survive. He would be devastated. He would roam the Middle Earth on his own, and he would fight the orcs, and then he would find another troop of people, and they would take him in, and he would gain their respect, and he would steer them up, and and so on. So I guess it was a curse. And the story about him and his sister, they were separated at a very young age, so they wouldn't recognize each other when they met each other. But Nienor, she was under the spell, some sort of spell that the father of dragons. Sorry, guys. Glaurung put on her. She was her mother. She and her mother, they were trying to find Turing because he wore different names and they didn't know where he is and what's with him, and they were trying to find him. But they found Glaurung instead, and Glaurung didn't kill them. He didn't kill Nienor, but he put a spell on her. So she didn't she didn't just forget her own name and her family, her father, her mother. She forgot her own language. So she didn't even remember the names of trees. And so people who took her in, they actually had to teach her language as though she was a child. So of course she didn't know that Turing was her brother. They met, I think he was, the wedding was postponed for 3 years, but they finally wed each other. And of course when it, when Glaurung made her remember everything, it didn't end well. And I think this is a very popular story, because this idea of siblings being separated at a very early age and then meeting each other and falling in love with each other, and then it would all end tragically. I think it was used in literature and in cinema times and times again. Well, the most surprising thing about this Silmarillion for me right now, it's that elves, well, I judged elves by Elrond, and I thought that they were this very clever, very experienced, very wise entities, ancient people. And the surprising thing is that they can be so quarrelsome, so begrudging, jealous, and sometimes almost stupid. It's the most surprising thing for me. Well, next time we will be reading chapters, I'm sorry guys, 22 and 23 and 24. Thank you for watching, goodbye and happy reading.